The following program is a special presentation of John Hagee Ministries.
I was privileged in the time that I was there to see life through the eyes of an orphan.
Hi, I'm Jacob. It's a pleasure to make your acquaintance. I'm supposed to look you in the eye and shake your hand with purpose when I meet new people. That's what my father showed me how to do. So if he asked, tell him that's what I did, okay? I've still got a lot to learn, and my dad is awesome. He helps me, and he helps a lot of other kids, too. I don't know exactly where he works, but I do know he spends a lot of time at Cornerstone Christian Schools.
So our God is a God of order. So when we solve things, even in math, we know that we do them in a set order.
Awesome, right? These kids are so smart.
So anytime we're looking at a math problem, we can't think it's reading.
You're not supposed to talk out of turn in class. It gets in the way of the learning.
Some of the big differences is that public schools can focus often on test scores and teaching kids what they need to know to be successful on a test. And here at Cornerstone, we really want to come alongside our kids and teach them what they need to be successful. Not successful on a test, but successful in anything that comes their way in life.
I believe the education is better because it's balanced. Instead of it being just about getting your grades right, you can go to tutoring with them, they can pray with you about a test, and it's just very wonderful. And you're learning, so that's awesome.
We talk about how God is a God in order. He wants things done in a specific way. So we can tie that into math. We can tie in really great foundational things of working with division, which kids love. Talk about Noah building the ark. We can pull that out of the Bible and actually do some math problems with that. But the overall understanding that our God is a God of order, that things take place and happen in a certain way, is great for the kids to understand that numbers were created by God.
When they come to our school and they catch you, like you said, in the parking lot or at church, and they tell you, listen, my daughter, my son's life was changed because of that school, because of that teacher, or there was something said in chapel.
The ability to integrate God's word in with the daily instruction, and then to hear the fruit of that, to hear the results of that process taking place.
Yes, I love to hear the great SAT scores. Yes, I love to hear of our kids going to military academies or being accepted into the Ivies, but it's those individual stories you hear from parents where they say, listen, our family's been changed as a result of our kids' experience at the school. Love to hear that.
As nice as this school is, it's nothing compared to what it's going to be like next fall. These kids have no idea how things are changing for them outside the classroom. Children aren't supposed to go here, but sometimes I sneak in and can see what the adults are doing. You're just not going to believe it.
When this campus is completed, there'll be capacity for 3,600 students here. Behind me is phase one, and that's gonna be completed in the summer of 2017, the school year of 2018, and house 1,300 students. Behind us, phase two, we're gonna be able to bring in another 1,300 students. Whenever all of this is accomplished and achieved, we'll have capacity for 3,600 students on this one campus with full athletic facilities, fine arts, drama, science, you name it. There will not be another school in the country that will have what Cornerstone Christian Schools has available to its student body.
Cornerstone wants to teach traditional values and a very important and grounded educational experience as well as moral experience. And so the look of the building helps reinforce the teaching that'll happen inside the building. We want the building to be timeless, and we want it to look like it's been there a long time.
Also, too, I think I'm excited about with this new campus will come a brand new dormitory. So we're very excited about the possibilities of children being able to come to us physically in that situation and be able to live here, be a part of the great San Antonio metro area, and certainly be a part physically of what we're doing on campus. Nationally, I think what sets us apart is the fact that many people don't realize that we have an online school. And in our online school, children can attend our online school from grades 3 through 12. And so they get a full program, a full curriculum. They get to experience everything there.
At Cornerstone, I teach online classes for them, their secondary mathematics course from algebra through calculus. And in their physical campus, I teach geometry, geometry honors, and an advanced math course. We pray with our students. We call them. We interact with them. They feel very comfortable asking us for help on the phone. And so it's not just a online community. You're spending time with them on the phone and maybe FaceTiming them, spending time explaining problems to them. So there's a lot more interaction than most online schools.
We love John Hagee. Every time he comes to Tulsa to speak, we go to listen to him speak. He's such a great, passionate, and inspirational person. And so when we started to do this, we thought, you know what? This is where we need to go. If we know we have a trip coming up and she can work ahead and get, you know, a week and a half ahead of her in her subjects, so when she goes on a trip, she can actually go and enjoy that time and not worry about school, because when she gets back, she's usually right where picking up where she left off.
They have so much flexibility outside of a physical campus environment. So I would tell them to definitely try it. They won't be disappointed. Their kid will be growing with their walk in God. They'll be getting rigor, even more rigor than they were getting at a physical campus. And they'll be spending a lot more time with their family.
I always wondered how computers work. I missed out of a lot of stuff like that. These kids are so stinking smart and lucky. Don't you just love big construction trucks? Hey! These kids just don't know how awesome they have it. If I could go to school, then I could maybe be somebody one day. I could do something important, like invent a thing that makes sure every baby is born. Always healthy, and happy, and smiling. My dad is working on this, too.
Wow! I bet those snacks taste so yummy!
The thing about being a regular kid is that you get all sorts of help. Grown-ups take care of you, you get to go to school, play on the playground, and all kinds of good things can happen to you. You make friends, you get snack time. Some kids don't. Don't ever. The people who are supposed to love you the most and take care of you the best sometimes make really bad decisions. Like, really bad decisions.
I found out I was pregnant. I was pretty excited. I was also scared. My daughter's father was out of the picture. He had abandoned us. When I told my boyfriend, I thought he'd be excited. He wasn't happy like I thought he'd be, but he wasn't angry either. We just started to have discussions about it, and saying we can do this later. We've only been together 9 months, but right now is probably not a good time for us. Why don't we wait? And since you're so early, I think we should just have an abortion. He offered to pay for it. The woman at the abortion clinic told me I was so early, so it wasn't really a baby anyway. And I looked at her and I said, are you sure? Are you sure that I should do this? She said, how far along are you? I said, I think about 6 weeks. She said, well, you're here right on time. It's not gonna affect you at all. Let's get this taken care of. We're just terminating a pregnancy, and you're gonna be fine. You can have more children later. You're healthy, and it's not really a baby anyway. It didn't take very long. I was just minutes, because I wanted to scream stop. I couldn't make myself say it. I wanted to say, wait, I changed my mind. As I'm laying there, I can remember thinking, looking up at the ceiling, going, no. And then remembering, gosh, but he's done that now. Now he's put that speculum, but now it's too late. And then it was too late. There were rows and rows of cots with women wailing.
They were just wailing. And they said, you need to lie here for 30 minutes and then you can leave. I didn't last 5 minutes. I said, you can't make me stay. And I knew immediately when I got on the elevator, I knew it. What you have just done has forever changed your life. You are never going to be the same. And then I went to bed. And I just stayed in bed for days. And then week. And another week. And I couldn't get out. And nobody knew what was wrong with me. Everything before there, when you find out you're pregnant and you're in this crisis, is all this just cloud of, okay, I need to hear what I need to hear. I need to hear because I've got to do this. This is the right thing. I've got to do it. Then as soon as it's done, it's gone and your reality hits and you're going, oh my God, what did I just do? And then the next 13 years, I walked around with my secret, didn't tell anybody. I couldn't even look in a mirror and mouth the words to myself because I was so ashamed. Because I am not the kind of person, even then, who didn't value life. I adore my children, they're my life. I'm a great mother, I was a great mother then. So all I needed was somebody to rescue me. And I know I would have that child here today. Yes, there's no doubt in my mind. I have these amazing, beautiful daughters who are these spectacular human beings. And I didn't give that child the chance to be a doctor or play sports or love his sisters, for them to love him. I robbed him. I robbed him of an amazing family.
When I'm feeling sad, this is where I go. My dad says this will be a place where everything could be different for moms who feel sad too. My dad says when it gets built, no one would ever hurt me. And my family would have gotten a chance to do things right. It doesn't look like much now, but boy, in a few years, it's gonna change the world and give kids like me a life. Dad says as much as he loves taking care of me, even he wishes my real dad had the chance to. When this gets built, that's going to happen to more kids like me and moms like mine. I hope I get to meet her one day.
I'm to have the facility with the unwed mothers and the children. Then the floor plans and the modularity of the buildings that we have currently are thought out to a level that they could be site adapted to other sites and other locations. This would really streamline the construction process and really get the buildings completed on a quick timeline in order to get the children and the mothers in as soon as possible.
These two guys can draw really good. This is my favorite picture. It's a room that will make so many kids happy. Kids and their moms who need a room like this to have the life God intended. It's not just my favorite. It's Pastor Hagee's too.
I want those of you who are here to take a really good look at this beautiful child. This is the very reason we are building the Sanctuary of Hope. Why don't you come get this precious baby and I'll talk to the people. This beautiful child is the reason why we're building the Sanctuary of Hope. We have known for a long time that the need in America is unlimited. There are thousands of children every day whose lives are being ended because young mothers feel they have no answer, they have no hope for help. The young child that I was just holding, her mother was considering abortion. But when at the last moment she found out that there was an answer, that someone would help her, this precious child was born.
Whenever you consider what might have been, there are literally 50 million what might have beens that have occurred with abortion. How many pastors, how many mothers and fathers, how many people did we throw away that we needed in society?
The sanctuary of hope is an anchor in the storm. It's a new beginning. It's to give you a new thought process that there is a loving God who has provided a way, and we're going to walk through this door for a new life for the child and a new beginning for the mother. When you save one life, you are saving the world. And Sanctuary of Hope is going to be saving the world one baby at a time.
My mom probably would have come here to a place like this if it had existed. My dad told me once, Jacob, the reason you don't know your real mother and father is because you died before you were ever born. He told me my mom made the hardest decision in her life, and as a result, she chose to sacrifice mine before I was born. Yeah, it could have been so different for me and her.
Ashamed of who I see here in the mirror, I can't even bear to look me in the eyes. The right decision could not have been clearer, but hopeless and afraid, I made you pay the price. Had the chance to hold a piece of heaven, but I chose me. In a moment I took everything away, before you ever even got to have a dream. What it comes down to when it came to me and you, I chose me. There's nothing that I wouldn't give to get to choose again, but no matter what, I'm stranded here with a memory. Chance to hold a piece of heaven, but I chose me. In a moment I took everything away, before you ever even got the chance to dream. What it comes down to when it came to me and you, I chose me.
I literally went into a place and let this man who had no feelings or sympathy for me take my baby. I don't deserve happiness. I mean, I killed my baby. As soon as I had an abortion and got off that table and was in that elevator, you know what those voices were saying to me? What kind of mother kills her children? What kind of woman are you that you deserve anything good that you could take the life of your own baby? A piece of me was gone that I couldn't get back. I didn't think I could get back. So it wasn't like I was that mom who never had kids and didn't know what it was like to have those maternal. I had it. I was a mom. So I had to reconcile all that in my head. And took me a long time. It was about 13 years before finally God brought me to a crisis pregnancy center.
And I went through post-abortion counseling, and then it changed my life again for the better. We tried to fill that hole with so many things, and the only thing that can fill it is God. Learn to know Him and accept His forgiveness and His grace and all those things, that hole was filled. I was a Christian and still wasn't healed from having an abortion. I mean, God forgave me. I begged Him to forgive me, so He had already forgiven me. But I was still this oozing, open wound walking around until I let Him say, I'm gonna take care of that for you. Because you're finally at your rock bottom. I've been trying to get you to let me. Now you're finally letting me. You just wait and see what we're gonna do now. And He's showed that to me so many times. But it is the truth. It is the honest to God's truth. He's the only one that can heal. He's the one man who's never lied to me. He's never betrayed me. He hurt me or abused me. What God showed me was, through my children first, He showed me about grace. He showed me about forgiveness. And then through my pastor and then my women's group, and then them asking me, will you share it with the church? And then I did, and that was it. When I never wanted to tell anybody, now I'm ready to sit down with anybody and say, this is what happened to me. Let me tell you why I wish I hadn't done it, but how God's taking what the enemy meant for evil and He's turning it into good by using my life for good to save lots of babies. My child didn't die in vain. An abortion, though, is a permanent solution to a temporary problem. And you can't go back. Places like Sanctuary of Hope and pregnancy centers across the country, they are vital to millions of women in this country who need another option rather than Planned Parenthood, that can be there just to love them, my gosh, just to listen and hold their hand and pray with them and let them know you're not by yourself. Yes, you maybe can't do this on your own, but you're not on your own. We're gonna do this together. People don't care how much you know. They want to know how much you care. So places like a Sanctuary of Hope, they're going to love and accept women. And that's what they need. They need to feel loved and accepted. Everything else will figure it out. But just let me know you love me. Do you truly care about me? Will you really walk through this with me? And when they know and trust that you will, the battle is almost won.
Stuff happens, I know. Sometimes mom and dads have it all mixed up, and they can make choices that hurt their kids. I'm okay with the choice my mom made because I know in my heart that my father loves me, and he always reminds me that he forgives my mom. Oh, my dad? He's your dad too, and he can forgive all of us. I guess we are all his kids. We are all family, aren't we?
Just like millions of babies before him, and sadly, after him, young Jacob was sacrificed before birth. Jacob never had a chance, a life, or a voice. Soon, with Sanctuary of Hope and your help, he will. Sanctuary of Hope, a sanctuary where young women who are pregnant and do not want to terminate their pregnancy may stay until the birth. A place where a child will receive a life sentence instead of a death sentence.
Do I think I would have changed my mind if I could have gone to a place like Sanctuary of Hope? No doubt in my mind. All I needed was for somebody to take me by the hand and say, I'm going to help you through it. You don't have to do this. There is another way. That's all I needed.
We have moved to the place that we're getting ready by God's grace and getting all of the red tape resolved to pour the foundation for the administration building of the Sanctuary of Hope. Please understand that none of this has been accomplished by the genius of men. It has only been accomplished by the goodness of God. God is the supplier of every need, and everything that has been done on this property, at the school, with the outreaches, with Sanctuary of Hope, Anything that we have done, are doing, or ever will do is only because of the goodness of God. Well, the first thing we need is something everybody can give, and that's your daily prayer, because prayer has an awesome power. It's the privilege to talk to God who controls the affairs of men. Secondly, we need a partner base in the Sanctuary of Hope that will give a monthly gift for its sustenance. The school has an educational foundation through the tuitions that are paid, but these children are totally dependent upon the charitable gifts of the body of Christ. And the people who work there have to be skilled people to help these children through the various stages of life. So we need a partnership base. Some of you may want to give a large initial gift to help us get through the process of this building, because we are building this as we go along. We are one third of the way in our fundraising schedule. We would like to be half of the way when we pour the foundation for the Sanctuary of Hope. And I'm asking the Lord to give us a multitude of monthly contributors, and then those of you who are financially capable of giving us right now, immediately, the best one-time gift that you can give to help us get this magnificent, life-changing, saving the world one life at a time, Sanctuary of Hope built. Thank you, and God bless you for what you do. This is a news update on the Sanctuary of Hope. Over my shoulder, you see the machinery preparing the foundation for the administration building. Because of you and wonderful people like you, we have begun, and we need to continue to make these beautiful 90 acres a place where thousands of children will come and be given the gift of life, have a place where people love them. The Bible says that the one who saves one life has saved the world. And we are here changing the world one life at a time. Thank you, partners, for your help. Keep it coming. We're doing a great work here at the Sanctuary of Hope.
Sanctuary of Hope, a vision that Pastor Hagee has cultivated into a solid plan for the future. But we need your hands to join ours and help us build the legacy our next generations deserve but cannot have without you.
This has been a special presentation of John Hagee Ministries.